Good morning, people of God. It is a joy to be with you this morning. It's a joy to lead you in worship. We have another special day today. So a couple Sundays ago, we got to celebrate a sort of celebration of discipleship for the end of our Sunday school year. Last Sunday, we got to celebrate, come on, Emily, turn your brain on. A children's choir, that's what it was. Children's choir was last Sunday. You would think I would know that. My kids sang in it. Today we get to celebrate our graduates, and so that'll happen later on in the service a little bit after the message. And then next Sunday, of course, is Father's Day, and so we'll be celebrating the men of faith in our community. Yeah, Nick, that means you. That's why he sits in the back. I'm just going to call him out. Nick said, yeah, when I said Father's Day. So yes, yes, you'll get a present too next Sunday, so come, okay? Good, excellent. A few quick announcements before we move into our time of worship. The first is that the prayer shawl group will be meeting this week. Also of note, there's a leadership team meeting coming up, and so if you have any information or questions or concerns that you'd like for the team to address, we always need that information at least a week before our meeting so that we have time to digest and process and think things through before we come to our meeting. And then the last announcement for today, you'll notice on the back of your bulletin and also in your newsletter that our church picnic is on Sunday, September 7th, which is a problem because September 7th is not a Sunday. It's meant to say September 17th, so take a pen, write a little one in there. September 17th, Sunday, September 17th, will be our church picnic. We'll hold it at the Seneca Lake State Park like we did last year. I know that's kind of pushing it into the fall a little ways, but we're going to be in the same enclosed pavilion that we were in last year, so if the weather is not fantastic, we can still make do. We'll be in a fully enclosed sort of space so that rain won't be an issue. I remember seeing fireplaces there even last year, so if it's unseasonably cold, which we'll hope it's not, we can warm our bodies as well as our hearts. Are there other announcements to lift up at this time? Oh, good. I like it when I don't forget. All right, then let's take a breath, center our hearts, and prepare to hear what God has to say to us this day. Would you join me in the responsive call to worship? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Jesus was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being.
What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people.
And the Word
from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ.
Let us praise God.
And let us do so by standing as we're able to join in singing, Morning Has Broken.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. And let us take a moment now to join our hearts in a prayer of confession. Shepherd of Israel, God of hosts, we have turned away from you, neglecting the welfare of your creation, ignoring the plight of your people, trampling on the creatures and the plants you have made, taking from earth what we cannot give back. We have not helped our neighbors in need, kept peace within our families, or tended the vine you have planted in our own lives. Forgive us and lead us to a more gracious life. In your compassion, turn us to your way. Restore us, O Lord God of hosts. Let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved. Amen. Beloved, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I invite the children to come forward if you want. If not, I'll come down anyway and talk to the children from home. You going to come hang with me? Cool. Thanks. I like your dress. We're kind of twinning. We've got that whole like black and teal thing going on. That's fun. I have a question. Have you ever read The Lorax, Dr. Seuss book? Yes. Do you remember what it's about? Yeah, that's right. It's like a story about when this man went to cut down trees and it was hurting the environment, what he was doing. Grown-ups, have you read The Lorax recently? Like within the last 30 years? It's all about knowing your congregation. So The Lorax, just a memory refresher, if you don't remember, is a Dr. Seuss story. And it's a story about this man who finds this forest full of truffula trees. And these truffula trees are extraordinary. Their texture, everything about them, they're just beautiful and extraordinary. And this man figures out that he can chop down a truffula tree and use the fibers of it, right? He like weaves them and makes, do you remember what it's called? That like, a thneed, yes, a thneed. A thneed is a thing that everyone needs. And so he makes this kind of crazy Dr. Seussian invention called a thneed, and he sells it. And then what happens? Right. That's exactly right. To make more, he's got to cut down more trees and more trees and more trees until there are no trees left. And all along, there's kind of this snowball effect happening, right? Like cutting down the trees makes it so that the animals who lived in the trees don't have a place to live, and then the air quality gets really bad, and then the fish can't swim in their lake because it's all sludgy and yucky from the runoff from his factory, right? How does the story end? Do you remember? No, that's okay. It's probably been a while since you read it. So the story ends by the onceler, who's the man telling the story to the main character, who goes to see the onceler. He throws something down at the kid who's hearing this story, right? Do you remember what it is? It's a seed, yes. It's the last remaining truffula seed. And he says to the kid, if someone like you cares an awful lot, that's how he phrases it, then things don't have to be this bad always, my paraphrase. That's kind of our job now, isn't it? To care an awful lot for the world around us. We have this conversation at home. You are much older than my Benjamin. My Benjamin is 4. You are 9, 10, 9, yes. Yes, my Benjamin is 4. You are 9. You know by now which things God made and which things people made, right? Like, Benjamin is very, very certain that God made trees and flowers and motorcycles. We know that this isn't true, that God made trees and flowers and the people who invented motorcycles, right? Our job as people who live in God's world is to take care of God's world. So what are some things that we can do to do that? Don't chop down trees. That's a good start. I'm thinking more like things that you could do. Like I'm hoping, Nick and Charity, that she's not chopping down trees at 9 years old as it is, right? No axes for children. So what are some things that you can do to help the environment, to help take care of the planet? You want me to give you some examples? I presume you brush your teeth every day, right? That's something you do to take care of your body. While you're brushing your teeth, do you leave the water running on the sink, or do you turn it off? That's a way that you're taking care of the planet. Saving water, exactly. Or, like, if you're a little bit thirsty, you don't go fill up a giant water bottle if all you need is a sip or two and then dump the rest down the drain, right? You take what you need and not anymore. Or you fill up your water bottle and then use it throughout the whole day so you're not wasting. What about lights in your house? When you're going through the house, do you turn off lights? Your mom's laughing. I can hear her behind me. We're all looking at Noelle. She's calling you out there, my dear. When you're home, you can turn off lights when you leave a room, right? Because when we use electricity, that takes up the Earth's resources to make the electricity. And so we don't take what we don't need, right? There are lots of ways. Just not littering is a good start, right? When we throw our trash out the window, then animals think that it's food and they try to eat it and then they get sick and then that hurts the animals. And so not littering is a good way to take care of the environment. One of my favorite things about our call as Christians to take care of the earth is that it's something everyone can do. You do not need to be old enough to vote. You do not need to be old enough to drive. You do not need to be a grown-up. You do not need to be rich or powerful or anything like that. Every single one of us is capable of doing something to take care of the earth. We're going to hear a passage from Genesis this morning. That's the first book in the whole Bible. We heard a passage last week that was all about how the world was created. And this week we're going to hear a little bit more about the sorts of things God put in the earth for the benefit of humans and for the glory of God. And so what I want you to do for me this week is try to find ways to take care of the earth that God made. Try to find ways that are available to you, and this is a call for God's children of all ages, to find ways that are available to you to take care of the earth that God made. Because it's a way that we can give thanks to God for all that God has done. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the planet. And for all that you have made. Thank you for trusting us with this great gift. Help us remember to take responsibility and to take care of your creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, my dear.
Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 through 17. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished in all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of God of good and evil. A river flows out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it divides and becomes four branches. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Hivlah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. From the day that you eat of it, you shall die."
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And thank you, Caitlin, for reading. I gave her one with hard names in it. She did a great job. I want to start by telling a story about my eldest. Many of you have met my Sarah. She is 9. She'll be 10 next month. She will be very quick to tell you that. And she has this passion for environmental justice or climate concerns or creation care, whatever terminology you want to give to it. She's very concerned about the well-being of the natural world. And so she told me that she wanted to start some kind of club, and could people please meet at our house on Saturdays? And I said, "I don't know, honey, Saturday is the one day mommy doesn't have to work, and so mommy likes to clean on Saturdays and not get dressed on Saturdays." And she said, "All right." And then a few days later, she came home from school and she said, "Mom, I started my club. It meets at recess every other day. My teacher said it was okay." All right. So this club is an animal advocacy club. Meanwhile, she's telling me about her plans for when she's an adult. You know, kids that age like to think about what they're going to be when they grow up. For the record, I knew two things for sure when I was that age. One was that I was going to be a medical doctor. The other was that I was never, ever going to work in a church no matter what. I wrote about that in my journal when I was a child. God had a laugh at that one. Sarah's plan is to be president.
Oh, my.
Oh, my, I know. And she said, "Well, Mom, surely before I'm old enough to be a president, some other woman will be a president and so make a way for me to do that." And I said, "Or you could just be the first if it comes to that. That's fine, too." But when I asked her why she wanted to be president, she said, "So that I can make people take better care of the earth." And so we talked about different jobs that would also accomplish that end, so that she can keep her options open. Now, I know two things when I think about Sarah and her passion for creation care. One is that very few of us are called to care for creation in the same ways as Sarah. I'm not expecting that we're going to start clubs. I'm not expecting that we're going to run for president anytime soon. But the other thing I know is that every single one of us who call ourselves Christians are called to care for creation. The scriptures are pretty clear about this, and they tell us this in a handful of ways. Sometimes they tell us that quite directly, that we are responsible for caring for that which God has given to us, and sometimes less directly by telling us things like what a magnificent creation the world is and how much detail and extraordinary wonder and awesomeness and beauty and power God knit into the creation that we have. But historically, there have been at least a couple different ways to interpret a lot of these passages. And to talk from a faith-based perspective about the relationship between we humans and the planet we inhabit. Especially this passage from Genesis and others like it, where God explicitly gives humankind dominion over the created world. There have been times in history when it has been assumed that that meant that the world belongs to us and we can do with it as we choose. In other words, the natural world is ours to have dominion over, and we have the God-given right to do with it whatever we want. Another interpretation of these texts, though, is that the natural world belongs to God and is sort of on loan to us, right? The scriptures say that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. I wonder, though, if the path that God intends is kind of a third way. There's a theological author, contemporary guy named Brian McLaren, who writes often about a third way, that Jesus often found a third way in either-or scenarios, and I wonder if there's some truth to that here. Imagine, if you will, a dining table, a wooden, handcrafted dining table built by someone you know, someone you care about, whether it's a friend or a neighbor or a family member. When I think of a handcrafted dining table, I happen to think of Phil Beals because I know that he built the dining table that's in his and Janine's home. Now imagine that table is on loan to you. You're having a family party, a birthday party, if you will, and you need more table space, and so the carpenter, the craftsman, the craftswoman loans the table to you so that you can have more seating at your gathering. When you have that table, you understand that it's there for you to use. It's not a museum table. You're not meant to just look and don't touch. It's meant to be used for its purpose. But also, heaven help my children if they take their fork and jab it into the handcrafted table, right? This is why we don't have nice things in my house. Maybe when they're older. Excuse me. We understand that this handcrafted creation is on loan to us both to be used and to be taken care of, right? I wonder if that's the relationship that God intends humans to have with the natural world. It belongs to God. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The scripture is pretty clear about that. But God has offered it to us for our use as long as we're here. Now, that doesn't give us the right to misuse or abuse it, but rather we recognize its extraordinary beauty, its extraordinary quality, the gift that it is to us while we're using it. And so we are called to take good care of it. Now let's take the table analogy just one step further before we get back on track. Imagine that this table was built explicitly with the purpose of being passed down as a family heirloom from one generation to the next. Not only are we taking care of it now out of honor and love and respect for the carpenter who built it, we are also taking good care of it so that it will last, right? So that it will be available, and not just available, but still beautiful and lovely and extraordinary for our children and their children and their children. Likewise, this magnificent planet that God has handcrafted
is meant for the use and enjoyment of humankind. But that doesn't give us the right to damage or abuse the creation. The second chapter in Genesis paints for us a beautiful picture of all that God included in this masterpiece: gardens and gold and life-giving rivers in every direction and fruit in abundance to nourish our bodies. The second chapter in Genesis also paints for us a beautiful picture of another part of the created world that God has made, and that is the inhabitants thereof. God formed humankind from mud. God breathed into humans the breath of life. We, one another, all humans, are God's creation just as much as the world in which we live. So as we talk about caring for the natural world, let's not forget that people are a part of God's creation too, and that all of this is interconnected. We cannot care for one another while not caring for the world in which we live. What then is our task? We know that this series that we're in the midst of through the 12-week-long summer, June, July, August, is sort of based on the social principles, which are the United Methodist Church's official position on some of the relevant contemporary topics that impact our life in society. What then is our task? Are we called to start clubs, to join Congress, to become president? Or my daughter's other idea, by the way, is that she knows that cars are bad for the environment, and so she's just going to ride horses everywhere when she's an adult. She is in horseback riding lessons. We're getting her ready. No, my guess is that very few of us are called to any of those things. Rather, our task as God's people and as United Methodists is to start by recognizing who and whose we are, to give praise to God, to start with honoring and glorifying God who made all that we are talking about today. We exist for the glory of God and the spreading of God's love. That's our purpose. And so we start by looking at the natural world around us. The rocks and trees cry out in praise. The world is full of God's glory. And so we start by looking at the world around us and simply reflecting on how awesome God must be to have made all of that. And as our eyes focus on our Creator, our hearts are drawn to care for the creation. And so, as an act of praise and thanksgiving, we keep moving toward perfection, as John Wesley would say. We get in the habit of turning off the bathroom sink while we brush our teeth, or we commit to eating a little less meat because we know that the processing of meat is harmful to the environment, or we carpool more, or walk or bike places if that's physically available to us. We reduce, reuse, recycle, right? That's the moniker these days. We reduce, reuse, recycle. We find whatever ways we can to participate in the healing of the earth. God is so good to us. God formed us, holy masterpieces that we are, and breathed life into us. God gave us this extraordinary sphere of sea and sky and river and mountain and meadow and desert and everything in between, all so that we might see God's glory revealed around us, and so that we might know how extravagant God's love for us is. And so in humbleness and gratitude, in honor, in glory and praise, let us live as a people who are grateful for this creation that God has loaned to us, so that it may be so beautiful for generations to come. Amen. Amen. I invite the graduates to come join me. Caitlin, you can stay down there. I'm going to come down. I'll get your paper for you. Poor girl. I would hate to be having to go up and down these stairs if I had an injury. All right. Ooh, I need my own paper, too. Fabulous. The moms and dads are all coming up front with their cameras. All right, my dears, I'm excited I get to hang with the two of you. All right, we have a really exciting opportunity this morning to celebrate a couple of our graduates, and so I think you know Noelle and Caitlin, and so we're excited to celebrate the two of them this morning. And so what I've asked each of them to do is to respond just to two sort of sentence starters, to kind of share a little bit of their hearts with you before we pray over them and give them some gifts. And when I do give you your gifts, I'm not going to give you your flower just yet because there's not really a steady place to put it in the pew, and I don't want it tipping over and spilling water everywhere. But you can take your gift bag with you, and then after the service, you can come up and grab your flower, and you get to keep the vase, too. So it makes it easy to take it home. Oh, and there's cake after church, like giant sheet cake. All right, so I have asked each of them to share a little bit of their hearts with us this morning, and so who wants to go first? Noelle wants to go first. Hi. Caitlin says so.
Great.
Okay.
So the two questions were, I'm grateful for this church because, and after graduation I plan to. So I'm grateful for this church because they've always given me support and shown me kindness in the, we've been here for a number of years.
Five-ish.
A number is a good answer.
Five-ish.
Okay, that's good. And they've just always been kind and supportive people, and that's really nice because I go to a public high school and you don't get that. After graduation, I'm going to SUNY Fredonia for theater arts with a minor in history.
That was much better than mine, but I had the same questions, obviously. I'm grateful for this church because you have always helped me in times of need and have always helped keep my faith strong. I know basically all of you. I've been going here since I was really, really little. Basically since I was born, so. And my plans after graduation is to work at Casa Wasco for the summer and then attend FLCC and then transfer to Nazareth for music therapy, so.
Thank you, thank you. All right, so here's what we're gonna do next. Can you turn this off? Thank you. He's so good to me. All right, here's what we're gonna do next. I am going to offer a prayer of blessing for the two of you, and then I'm gonna give you your presents, and then we're all gonna clap because we love you and we wanna celebrate you. Sound good? Good. Caitlin's like, no. But whatever you say, Pastor Emily. Let's pray. You, great teacher, guide us all as students of life lived in faith. Since before written word, you have walked with us in our struggles and in our celebrations. It was you bursting old wineskins with new wine on the mount. It was you feeding the multitudes with your words on the plain. It is you who are the light that is passed from generation to generation in the journey of life. And God, it is you walking with these graduates as we bless them in your name. Continue to walk with Caitlin and Noelle. May God's bright flame from the lamp of knowledge guide them. May God's warm glow off the pages of the scriptures comfort them. May the cool baptismal waters of God continue to refresh them in their endings and new beginnings. And Noelle and Caitlin, may your soul always be fed at Christ's table. May your heart always be open in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And may your mind be transformed in the presence of the great I am. God is with you. God is with us. Go with God. Amen. All right. Noelle, this one is for you. Caitlin, this one is for you. If you were my children, I would say, don't worry, they're identical except for the name on the envelope. Everyone gets the same thing. We don't play favorites. Friends in faith, I would invite us to celebrate these two young people who are going with God on their journeys. All right, you can go ahead back to your seats. Thank you so much. And that, my dears, is a really lovely segue into celebrating our joys and concerns as we come together in prayer with and for one another. So, of course, it is a joy to celebrate our graduates and to celebrate the good work that God has done in their lives. It's been a joy to watch them grow in their faith and in their knowledge of God's word as they've been with us these last years. Another joy that was submitted, many thanks to Deb McLaughlin for organizing our congregation's participation, along with the Seneca Falls United Methodist Church. We were the two reconciling congregations in the area, and so we had a booth at yesterday's Pride Festival down by the lake, and it was fun to meet a bunch of new people and to kind of be there and show our support. We've been asked also, though, to pray for all the mourning families in Richmond, Virginia, who lost loved ones in a mass shooting that happened recently. And so prayers specifically for those impacted by that, and more broadly for an end to gun violence in our nation and in our world. We continue to pray for Valencia, and we continue to see support coming in for her. And so, if you're not aware, Valencia is a friend of our faith community who's affiliated with us through Cecil. She lost her house in a tragedy a little over a week ago, and so we are supporting her in whatever ways we can, including with our prayers and financial gifts as we're able. If you're able to help Valencia out, please either let me or Cecil know, and we'll make sure the support gets to her. Other joys or concerns to lift up that didn't make it into our prayer book? Yes, yeah, Sam, hold on, let me come down to you so that I can hear you all the way in the back. You got them written down for me? Okay, perfect, thank you so much. Friends, I think I've said this before, but I just want to celebrate it again. We all have spiritual gifts that are given to us by God. Sam has the gift of prayer. He's got such great compassion for the people of the world. And so he always comes to me with a list of prayers that we are to be lifting up. All right, so Sam's asking us to pray for a number of things, for those impacted by natural disasters around the world, and for those impacted by violence at the hands of people. Prayers for some political tensions that are happening in different parts of the world, and especially amongst the U.S. and China and Ukraine and Russia and some other political tensions that are weighing heavy on Sam's heart. We're also asked to pray for some of the personal challenges that Sam is experiencing. It's a difficult season for him, and so we continue to hold him in support and in love and in prayer. I'm just skimming through. Yeah, that's right. Specifically, while we're praying for the impacts of natural disasters, we're thinking of the wildfires in Canada and the impact they had on us here this past week. It's not a new phenomenon that there are wildfires raging in our world. It's maybe new in a poignant way for us to experience so directly their impact. And so let that be a call to care. Prayers for those whose travel plans were impacted, too, by the wildfires, that there were a lot of flights delayed and whatnot because of visibility concerns, and prayers for prayers for our own nation in a time of political turmoil. Typically on the first Sunday of every month, we celebrate the birthdays in our congregation. Last Sunday, I got carried away with myself and preached way too long, so thank you those of you who hung through the whole service with me. But because of that, we didn't celebrate birthdays then, so I wonder if we could celebrate our June birthdays now.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Let's pray. God of grace and mercy and joy and celebration, we praise you for all that you are. When we look at the earth, the works of your hands, we are awestruck and amazed, O God. And so we give you all honor and glory and praise. You are powerful and you are good. You are perfect, and you are merciful. You, O God, are love in its purest form, and we love you so much. Even so, we confess, O God, that we have not always loved well. We have fallen short in loving you with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength, and in loving our neighbors as ourselves. Forgive us, we pray. And all the while, we express our gratitude, for we know that you already have forgiven us, that your mercies are new every morning, that your grace is upon us. We give you thanks for all the blessings you give us, for the joys of celebration, for discipleship and growth, for the faith community that supports and embraces one another, and for the ways in which we care for each other and for our world. We pray, O God, for those in special need of your care this day. And so, in the stillness of this moment, we think of all those who are ill or injured, in mind, in body, or in spirit. We pray for those who are grieving. For those who are living in fear or in violence. For those experiencing scarcity or poverty. For those who are battling addictions, for the imprisoned and the oppressed. God, we pray for your healing, your peace, your provision, and your freedom for all your people everywhere. And we humbly ask that you would use us to do the work that would bring about those glorious ideals. We know that all things are possible through you, O God, and so we give you our lives and our hearts. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take a moment now to continue to live out our prayer as we give back to God a bit of that which God has given to us.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me.
Amen. Please be seated as we join together in a moment of prayer. All things come from you, O God, and with gratitude we return to you what is yours. You created all that is, and with love formed us in your image. When our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. All that we are and all that we have is a trust from you. And so, in gratitude of all your gifts, we offer you ourselves and all that we have in union with Christ's offering for us. By your Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world through Jesus Christ our Savior. And in his name we pray together the prayer he taught us as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved, one of the things that I've been asked to do each week, because I tried it once and y'all liked it so much, is to offer a little nugget that you can take home with you, a little homework, if you will. And so our call this week is to find one new habit you can adopt to take better care of the earth. One new habit you can adopt to take better care of the earth. If you don't already, that could be turning your sink off while you're brushing your teeth. I mentioned that a few times because it's a little daily thing that has a powerful impact overall. If you don't already, you could adopt meatless Mondays. If you're eager for recipes, let me know. We have a lot of meatless meals at my house. If you're someone who drives a lot of places, maybe you could find a way to do that less, to carpool or to line your errands up so that you're only coming out into town once if you live a ways away. There are so many things that we can do to take better care of the planet. So pick one thing, just one, and be really intentional about getting into that new habit. And if you're a kid whose grown-ups pay the power bill, that means turn the lights off when you leave the room. That's for my kids at home, too. All right, let's take a moment now to celebrate all that God has said to us this morning by standing as we're able to join in singing, Let All Things Now Living.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated to receive these words of blessing and the blessing of the music that follows. May it be that as you go from this place, you look around you and see all that God has made. And may the wonder and beauty and power and majesty of it all remind you that God made you too, knows you, and loves you, no matter what. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you.